Well, thank you, Henrik, for that very kind introduction. And I'm sure the best scenario is for me to be standing right here with all of you today and not in a stuffy meeting room somewhere in the U.S. government, although I can't say that it's better for our society in general, but that's a subject for another day. It's an honor to be here at the Hertie School of Governments today and to address the 2018 graduating class of the Executive Masters in Public Administration. The Hertie School of Governance is an institution that actually I've been following pretty closely since it was founded 15 years ago. And I've always been impressed by its innovative curriculum, the emphasis on practical experience, all of the professors that find their way to this great institution, and of course all the students that come from around the world. Let me start first by congratulating all of today's graduates. Very well done. Congratulations on your degree from such a fine institution and such a distinguished program. I had the pleasure of reading through your bios in recent days. They were all sent to me, and I took the time to sit down and read through all of them. And it's clear that you're a very impressive group of young professionals. You've set yourself apart already professionally. Many of you already have two or three other advanced degrees, and you're clearly on your way to do great things in the future. Now, that's just what I know from reading your bios, but even without reading your bios, I know a couple of other things to be true. First, you're a group of risk takers. You've never opted for the easy route. You didn't stay in your hometown to study, to work, to settle down. Irrespective of your particular field or area of specialization, you have lived, studied, and worked abroad, and you've just completed a degree in English in this wonderful city of Berlin. Making choices like that, to leave your hometown, to get a degree in a foreign language, to work in another country, takes courage and a willingness to step into the unknown. I also know that all of you love learning. As I said, most of you already have other advanced degrees, and at a time in life when many of your peers no doubt feel like they are long done with school, you decided to return to school, to take classes in economics, in management, and leadership. And on top of it, you selected a program that requires you to write a thesis, something that would have sent at least a few applicants running in the other direction. I also know that you're all multitaskers extraordinaire. Some of you have completed this program while working full or part-time. I know that there are parents in the group and managing family responsibilities. Some of you have also seized on opportunities to take courses at other universities across the continent. And not everyone has the discipline, the flexibility, the time management skills to do just that. But you do. In short, you're a remarkable group of young professionals, mid-career professionals, clearly on your way to do great things. So what's my message for such an extraordinary group and very impressive group? Well, I'm going to be honest with you. 5 or 10 years ago, I probably, or maybe 2 years ago, I would have used this address to focus on leadership, since you've all established yourself as leaders in your field, and you just completed a program that focuses specifically on questions of leadership. I would have drawn from some of my own experiences, as well as the lessons that I've learned in working for some of America's top national security professionals. I would have stressed the importance of managing up and managing down. I would have offered some suggestions on how to best inspire and support the people who work for you and work with you. I would have stressed the importance of finding balance in your life and avoiding the trap of putting too much emphasis on your professional life at the expense of your personal life. And I would have put special emphasis on innovation, not just in what you do, but in how you do it. But I'm going to be very honest with you right now and tell you that those lessons and that kind of advice feel pretty small to me. They feel small because of the transformative moment that we find ourselves in today. We are living in an age of disruption where the structures and the systems that worked so well for us in recent decades are cracking from outside pressure, from internal forces, or both. Populist winds are blowing on multiple continents. Authoritarians are doing their very best to attack the democratic values we hold dear, and people around the globe are losing their faith in the institutions that would normally help us weather the storm. So I want to spend a little time today talking about that storm and what I think it means for all of the graduates with us here today. And I want to start by talking about the issue of public trust. And I saw that on a poster out in the hall a few minutes ago. Public trust, as you may all know, in national governments remains at near historic lows, both on my side of the Atlantic and on your side of the Atlantic. In my own country, the United States, there's an organization called National Election Study, and they began asking Americans about their trust in national government in the late 1950s. At that time, about 3/4 of Americans trusted the federal government to do the right thing, most of the time or all the time. Since then, public trust in the government has dropped significantly. And for the past decade, the share of people in the United States saying that they can trust the government always or most of the time has not surpassed 30%. Now, this isn't just an issue in the United States. I've taken some time in recent weeks to look at similar polls in OECD countries. And on average, citizens in OECD countries have less confidence in their national governments today than they did 10 years ago. In some OECD countries, Finland, Belgium, South Africa, to name just a couple, confidence in national government is actually plummeting. And I'll give you an example. In 2004 in South Africa, 66% of the public had confidence in national government. By 2014, it had dropped to 34%, where it sits today. Now, declining public trust isn't limited to national governments. We see public trust also declining in other institutions, in NGOs, in courts, in banks, and the media. And that's just at the national level. You can also take a look at public trust in the alphabet soup of international institutions that serve as the foundation of the liberal order, whether you're talking about the EU, NATO, the OSCE, or the UN, and you can find similar trends in those institutions. According to the Eurobarometer, the percentage of Europeans that said in 2004 that they trusted the European Union was around 60%. By 2015, that number had dropped to just 36%, although I will note that trust increased just a few points when that same question was asked last year. 42% of Europeans now say they support the European Union. Now, that's better than the 36% we saw in 2015, but it's certainly not the 60% that Europe witnessed a little over a decade ago. Now, switching to the UN, Secretary General Guterres has spoken many times about declining trust in the institution that he heads up. Just a few weeks ago, he pressed UN member states to pay their dues, warning that this year's cash shortfall is far worse than in past years. And as he did that, Guterres speculated that declining support for the United Nations, not just in the United States, but actually in many countries around the world, might be one of the reasons that countries are so late in paying their dues this year. Now, switching to NATO, public support for NATO isn't declining quite as fast as it is in some other institutions, perhaps due to its ties to the military, which continues to benefit from high levels of trust on both sides of the Atlantic. But I can tell you from firsthand experience that we are starting to see some cracks in NATO's armor. I've spent the last year traveling across the United States to engage new audiences on U.S. foreign policy and the transatlantic relationship. And engaging Americans in places like Salt Lake City, Tampa, and Pittsburgh, I have regularly encountered disparaging remarks on the left and the right about NATO that mirror those made by President Trump. NATO's obsolete, they tell me. Europe isn't paying their fair share, others have said. NATO doesn't benefit the United States in any concrete way, they've told me. And I worry about the damage those arguments will ultimately do to NATO's public image in the United States and Americans' faith in the alliance. I also worry about the views of a new generation of foreign policy hands in the United States and Europe that have little to no recollection of the Cold War and why NATO was invented in the first place. But that's a subject for another day's lecture. In any case, my point here is that whether you're looking at public trust in national governments or national institutions like courts and banks or international institutions, the trend lines are all pointing in a troubling direction. So the question is, what accounts for this shift? What's the cause behind this decline in public trust in these institutions? And of course, as you all well know, there are many causes: economic recessions, political scandals, declarations of war, terrorism, or an institution's failure to adequately cope with a crisis or a catastrophe. And here one could cite the Japanese government's handling of the Fukushima nuclear disaster and the resulting drop in public trust that followed that catastrophe. Now, some experts, like the economist Justin Wolfer, also credit enhanced transparency as a contributing factor to our collective lack of trust in government. Citizens today have more information, more knowledge about how government works than their counterparts did many, many decades ago. Now, one would think that that increased level of information and all of that transparency would actually build trust in institutions, but that's not necessarily the case. In some cases, increased transparency in these institutions has revealed their inefficiencies and, in some cases, corruption, leading folks to the conclusion that a particular government agency or multilateral institution isn't fit for the job. And there's another problem with enhanced transparency. Our inboxes, everyone in this room, they're all now overflowing with information that spans the full spectrum from fact to fiction and everything that falls in between. Misinformation, sometimes coming from within our own societies and sometimes coming from outside our own societies through our adversaries looking to shape our national discourse, has left citizens struggling to identify what is good journalism rooted in facts and what's merely a ploy full of falsehoods. That uncertainty about what's fact and what's fiction and the accompanying loss of trust in institutions is shaking the very foundation of our democracies today. Without an agreed upon set of facts and without confidence in national and international structures, it's virtually impossible for us to engage in rational discourse and chart a common way forward. So as people worry about the future, they worry about their jobs, globalization, migration, and a long list of other challenges, what are we finding? We're finding that some of them are drawn towards populist candidates that promise to take the authority away from the institutions that these individuals no longer trust. And that disruption can have tremendous appeal, as we've seen both in the United States, in my country, and throughout Europe. Disruption can feel like a tonic, particularly when you believe that the system, however you define the system, is somehow leaving you behind or has failed to meet your needs. Now, while some level of disruption can be healthy, you all know it's a term that's used in a very positive light in Silicon Valley, it can also come at a cost, triggering a liberal slides that erode our democratic values and the rule of law. The question now is, how do we acknowledge some of the legitimate concerns of our fellow citizens without bringing down and disrupting the entire system? How do we restore public trust in so many national and international institutions that, at least in my mind, need to be reformed and not destroyed? These are some of the challenges that sit at the heart of the transatlantic relationship today. So the question is, what does this mean for all of you freshly minted graduates? Well, it means you now need to set your sights just a little bit higher. You need to do more than to be leaders in your field, something I'm confident you're already doing or are this close to achieving. You need to be leaders in society and in your communities more broadly. That means you're going to have to continue to rely on those multitasking skills that I mentioned at the beginning, in addition to pursuing a rewarding career, either in the public or private sector. I'm asking you today to consider doing the following 7 things. First, ground yourself in the truth. Work to identify trustworthy outlets and take the necessary time to determine if all of your sources are indeed rooted in facts. More importantly, call out those that are deliberately misleading others. You may know that Muslim refugees in Germany are not, in fact, demanding that the city of Munich ban Oktoberfest, as one social media post claimed in 2015. But what will you do when you hear a neighbor or a friend promote a post like that? Second, define your values and prepare to defend them. In the past, many of us may have felt like that was the job of our elected leaders, but your elected leaders now need your help. This isn't a time to be passive. This moment in time requires us all to take religious, racial, and social divisions head on, and it requires all of us to find our voice. Third, avoid groupthink. Social media, as you all know, has a way of trapping us in this echo chamber where we're all surrounding ourselves with like-minded souls. If you are on social media like I am, often too much, I urge you to very deliberately follow people who disagree with you. Better yet, get off social media and meet with people who disagree with you. Fourth, be a leader in civility and decency. In today's hyperpartisan atmosphere, particularly in Washington, but not just in Washington, we're seeing tempers flare, insults fly, and in some cases, violence break out. I therefore encourage you to remain passionate about your views, your belief systems, but also urge you to police and check your language and be careful not to cross the line. Fifth, find new ways to invest in your communities, as I'm sure many of you are already doing. And don't limit your contributions to your professional life. Find other ways to connect with your community. Work with kids or the elderly, start a book club, organize a neighborhood picnic. And sixth, serve as a translator. You guys are in a unique position of straddling many different worlds, different cultures, and different fields. I want you to think about how you can serve as a translator between those worlds. Maybe you happen to have a deep technical knowledge from the private sector that an NGO down your street would really find helpful. Maybe you happen to have a unique understanding of two cultures or two religions that are at cross purposes right now. Maybe you can help bridge the gap between the private and the public sector on national security challenges like cybersecurity. And maybe you could share your own personal experience working at the UN or for a government agency with a neighbor or an uncle or a friend who's lost faith in those institutions. Finally, assuming you're all advocates of the transatlantic relationship, and I hope you all are, please don't fall into the trap of defending the status quo, something that I've caught myself doing on a few occasions. It's not enough to say that the old order, the old structures worked most of the time. It's also possible to defend the liberal order and advocate for change all at the same time. If we want the order to prevail, we need to work to prepare it for a new era. We need to have difficult conversations about the post-manufacturing economy, the impact of artificial intelligence and other disruptive technologies, about preserving our values while also being more inclusive, and about globalization. I'm counting on all of you to lead those conversations. I'm counting on the skills that got you to this institution in the first place, your willingness to take risks, your adaptability, your resilience, your intellectual curiosity, and your drive. So go home, celebrate today's major, major milestone, but then jump to it. We've got work to do. Your colleagues need you, your communities need you, society needs you. Thank you very much, and congratulations again.